Putting up fires don't really work when you're a single mom and you cannot rely on people. So I really need to set myself up for success. Welcome back, everyone. In today's minisode, I'm going to share with you my journey as a single mom to become a better investor. And for those of you out there that are going through either a divorce or any type of separation, and you're wondering, can I really do it on my own? The answer is yes. And I'm going to share with you here my top three strategies, not tips, strategies that I did and I still do in my life. So needless to say, right? Let's just start with a disclaimer, shall we?
Yeah, it's an important disclaimer.
Needless to say, having a partner in your business, in your life, is super powerful. When both individuals are working on themselves, the relationship benefits, the business benefit, and it's beautiful to see. When that's not the case, it's really like draining, right? It's like you are building that's how I felt. I was building a real estate business, holding a bowling ball on both sides. Right. So I think that for all the parties involved, when it's not working, when you release that, there's a big change. And I'm not saying it is easy, right? But the transition is necessary. And setting yourself up for success is the most important thing. You will not have all the answers on the first year, 2 years. You might not. Okay, but one thing that you can do is set yourself up for success. And I'm going to share here with you the three things that I did and I continue to do in my business. I do believe heartily that becoming a single mom made me a better real estate investor, hands down. So the number one thing is planning ahead. I can't emphasize this more, right? Putting up fires don't really work when you're a single mom and you cannot rely on people. In my case, my family is in Brazil. My mom spends 6 months here during summertime, smart mama. And then when it's in wintertime, she is in Brazil. So I really need to set myself up for success. So here's how we do it, because all the moms are saying, well, I'm trying to do my best, right? So here's one thing that I start from that point and move forward. And the question is that I'm going to put it for you. Where are the places that you cannot be substitute? For example, picking up my son from school, doing homework with him. Those are the times that it's me because I want to, not because I have to, because I want to. And I build my schedule all around. When I am with my son, there are no outside of state trips if I am not there with him, right? So think about this. You get to start with your priorities in relationship with your child. If you don't have a child, with yourself. Where are the areas where it must be you? And of course, I'll give an example, right? All the single people are saying, oh, what about me? You're the only one that can go to your checkup, right? Your doctor checkup. So schedule that ahead. Did you schedule your mammogram this year? Well, that's a big reminder for you, for all of us, right? We can't substitute that. So planning our health, our mental health. You have a therapist, right? It needs to be me coming to my therapy session. It cannot be somebody else. So that is all blocked. Vacations are blocked. All the foundation is really blocked. That allows me to have much more time when I am working on my business. I am 100% body, mind, and soul present, and therefore I'm more efficient.
It makes complete sense. I'm wondering though, just to ask you, do you feel like becoming a single mom? Not going to say forced, but there's only no other way, right? In terms of planning ahead, it's not like, or were you like that prior? And it just really created more of that in your life in terms of planning ahead. Because just knowing you and knowing the one listening, right? Some people are naturally that way and they have to be more of it. I'm just curious to get your thoughts on that for ladies listening who struggle with that.
Yeah, that's a good question. To me, it was actually a positive surprise. Of course, you have doubts in terms of, am I able to handle it? The same way, it's not the same. It's different. It forced me to really focus on, do I really want to rehab 15 properties at the same time? The answer is no. So if I was or was not in a relationship, the answer was no. So I believe that, as you're saying, it forced me to really think what really matters to me and where should I put my time based on my core genius, based on how I feel. But I had to be really determined and dedicated to do that. Otherwise, I would be putting up fires and taking care of different things. It's too many different types of situations coming at once. And if we don't prioritize, in my case, what I was forgetting, my health.
Well, you. Yeah.
My appointments.
Absolutely.
Because I was trying to make sure that everybody else was good, right? Because they were in front of me. But I am behind my eyes. So I was my own blind spot.
Mm.
I forgot appointments until I got letters and reminders that my mammogram was delayed. Right? So what's the point here? So planning ahead is the key, ladies, and dedication and commitment to yourself is the most important thing. Second thing, which is related, right? Establish priorities. I hear you. The list goes on and on. When you're at your desk and when you're outside, the list goes on and on. One thing that I had to shift, instead of like looking at, oh, damn it, I couldn't complete this, whatever that is, today, I expanded to, okay, how can I adjust my week instead? Otherwise, I will feel like a failure, just pushing things around and around because I couldn't, right? So my question to you is, when you think of your week, not your day, your week, what are the top three things, the top three that are the most important? I didn't say easy. I didn't say that those things that you really want to do it. No. What are the three things that if you say, oh, if those three things are completed, I will feel really good at the end of my week. So let me repeat. What are the three things that at the end of your week, if you complete them, you will feel really good about it? Those are your top priorities.
I was working with my coach and we were talking about priorities and just working through some things. And she goes, okay, I want you to, she gave me an exercise and we do things on the call together. She goes, I'm going to have you do three priorities for the day. And so I said, okay, great. And then what I did was I created 10. And then I said, I actually created 10 because I didn't listen to you. You know, 10's better than three anyway. She's like, I completely disagree. So for the women listening that are like, no, three just seems so, really? It actually is more powerful because it refines you. What Andresa is saying is you have this ability to discern what's important. So if you had 10 priorities, you have no discernment. Everything has an equal importance, which actually doesn't make you effective or as efficient, actually. It actually decreases your efficiency. And she was kind of explaining a little of that to me. I'm like, oh, all right, definitely want three then. So I just want to say that for the woman that went to like, I'm not going to do three, I'm going to do 10. No, don't do that because you will not be as efficient.
And it's more difficult to come up with three. It's more difficult to come up with three than come up with 10. Come up with three forces you to really think. You can come up with 10 and you start crossing the ones that you start comparing. How about this with that? Which one? And you're going to end up with three. And the key here is unless you complete those three, don't do anything else. Because that's what's going on. Now, if you are avoiding, procrastinating, if you procrastinated that item for the past 6 months, I have news for you. You're not going to do it. Okay? It's too painful. It's a sign. Somebody else needs to do it. And that's what your job will be, to find who will be doing it. Now I'm going to go to my last and final super quick here because we're already past 10 minutes. And this is a quick shot for you. Liz, the last one is crucial. It's creating a support system. And all the single moms are like, well, I don't have it. My family doesn't live over here, don't have too many friends. My partner was my support system. I can, it's countless amount of women, when I ask them, they are in a relationship, married or not, that they say that their support system is the spouse. Nothing wrong with that, but that's not enough. That is not enough. It's too much pressure on the other person for that person to be your all, right? For everybody.
Completely agree.
Come on. It's too much, right? So when you think, when your single mom's out there, I hear you. My family does not live close by, right? I have a strong core of friends. I want you to start writing down, who do you have? Write down, pull your phone. Who are in your contacts? Check your Facebook. Who can you rely on? And if you still don't have anybody, I encourage you to come to our local meetups and start building relationship with women. You're going to find others exactly like you. You're going to come to our Facebook group community and you're going to find women exactly like you. We have countless conversations behind the scene of women going through different types of divorce and separation. And there is a big question mark happening. We're just not talking about it, but that has to stop. Now we're going to start talking much more about it, right? And I'll share my experience, what worked, what didn't work. But I want you to feel that you are not alone on this journey and you can do it. Thanks so much for listening.